Hi, Angela. I just wanted to thank you so much for taking the time to do this. I know you're super busy right now, and it means a lot to me, and I know it'll mean a lot to the students who get to watch this. So thank you.
You're welcome. Sorry, my hair is not dry for this. It might be dry at the end.
I think you look great. So let me jump right in. We've talked a lot in the last few days about how our communities are adjusting to this new way of living, but I actually want to focus today on those of us who are lucky to be safe and secure and are coping with now a new ordinary and a new ordinary set of challenges, like how to stay productive and upbeat when we're working from home. So I want to start with just asking you what advice you would offer people who are struggling to form new and effective work routines from home. So, for instance, I'm thinking about challenges like overcoming the urge to binge consume COVID-19 social media all day instead of staying focused and on task. What tips do you have?
Well, my particular challenge is that my back hurts. I think I've, been somebody who, spent a lot of time in front of a keyboard and in front of a monitor. So I had adjusted, my lifestyle a little bit, but now I'm not walking to work and, I feel like the number of video calls has tripled. And so I was wondering what I could do about it. And I was talking to a friend actually who said, I'm taking all of my meetings that don't require me to be like literally looking at a spreadsheet or editing a document, taking all of them walking. And I thought to myself, like, my gosh, that's a great idea. I'm going to copy paste that idea into my life. And I know you and I both think that copying and pasting strategies that, friends or anybody that we see, honestly, who's been successful, like that's such a great, way to be. So I have copy pasted that, and it's working. My back hurts less. I think for, your own particular issues, are you on the like social media sites more than is healthy, or are you like getting mad at family and friends who are a little, I guess it's in this case mostly family, like getting on your nerves? I think asking our closest acquaintances by texting them or having some kind of obviously virtual contact and figuring out what they're doing and then doing it yourself. I think that's kind of the meta strategy for success in life, and that includes now.
Great advice, and I'm totally going to copy and paste that myself. The second thing I wanted to talk about is what people can do for their mental health at this stressful and frankly lonely time. Do you have any insights on, or the insights from behavioral science that you think can help with that issue?
I think the most reliable predictor of happiness is close personal relationships. The more you have, at least, one, two, three people in your life, you say with full confidence that you feel connected to another person, they know, what's going on in your life, the happier you are. And the opposite of that is loneliness. And loneliness is, maybe the largest negative predictor of, feeling happy with your overall life. So what do you do now when so many of us are in physical isolation? I think the point has been made by others, but I will just reaffirm it that social distancing is probably not the right term. It really should just be physical distancing. I mean, I actually have spent more time talking to my extended family in the last week or two because we have these, like, I guess they're like Zoom video dinner calls where we literally put my phone in an empty glass and then we put it. Actually, one of my brothers said, he's like, wow, this is like really being at your dinner table. And I'm like, yeah, you are at the head of the table if you want to know where you're actually sitting. So, that's physically distancing ourselves from people we otherwise might see in person, but it's socially, quite intimate. And I know social media has been, maybe rightly criticized over the last few years about its negative effects. But here's one thing that I think we could all be grateful for. Like without the internet, without technology, and without these, ways of connecting with each other virtually, I think we would be much worse off.
Couldn't agree more. And I really love that tip to, bring people to your dinner table by connecting with them over the phone. That's a wonderful idea. I also wanted to acknowledge that a lot of people were working towards big goals before the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic and are now faced with this new stumbling block in light of what's going on. And I wanted to ask you what advice you would have for people who are facing new roadblocks to achieving whatever it is they've set out to achieve as a result of their new circumstances. What advice do you have for them?
Right before the pandemic really became a kind of conscious reality in the United States, and right before spring break for Penn, I assigned in my undergraduate class an 8-week passion project. I said, you know, we've had enough weeks together that you should be able to make the commitment to go all in on a passion project for the last 8 weeks of the semester. And I will see you when you get back from spring break. Okay, well then, you know, a lot happened. And so many of my students wrote to me and said, you know, well, my 8-week passion project was going to be to volunteer in a hospital. I think I might want to have a career in health or medicine. Like, I guess that's not happening. What do I do? And I said to my students, actually, during my first online class, which I had 2 days ago, that I can't answer the question what specifically each individual student should do now that this big goal has been made impossible, like literally impossible for so many students. But I can give them the general direction that when we have any project, no matter how big, there is always an even bigger question or concern or purpose for that project. What were you trying to do in those 8 weeks? Well, I was trying to figure out if I want to be a doctor someday. All right, well, a lot of the obvious ways to do that are now gone, but there might be other things that you can do. And actually, in this interaction with the student, you know, they had an interest in a very specific health disorder. And then there was the idea that, like, maybe, you know, there would be a way through social media to, like, keep a blog on this and to, you know, learn more from other people who are, you know, in that field, but maybe virtually. So I'm not saying it's easy, but I do think that every big goal has an even bigger goal. And when you go up a layer in your goal hierarchy, as it were, and you say, like, well, what's above this goal? What was the point of this? It does give you the flexibility, I think, to back up and then to, you know, move forward in a new direction.
That's great. So basically, don't give up on those goals that feel like they've been blocked. Think about what the greater goal was and another way that you can get there under these new circumstances.
Yeah, you might have to give up on, you know, the specific tactic that you're going to put. You know, most of the things that we're doing are means, not ends. So yeah, ask yourself, like, what was the end of this? And then maybe there's a different means.
Okay, I want to end with a upbeat question. We've talked a lot over the years about how changes in circumstances often lead people to pause and think bigger about their lives and try to change for the better. And I want to ask you, if somebody wanted to seize this disruptive moment to actually try to start fresh on something, say eating healthier, exercising more, increasing their charitable contributions, finding meaning in new places, what advice would you give them to help turn those new ambitions into a reality?
You know, this crisis is, in a way, and I know you've used the term fresh start, Katie, like, it is a fresh start in a sense. It doesn't feel like that. It feels just like a crisis. But, you know, whenever you have a disruption in your usual routine, whenever you're kind of forced out of habit, then I think there is an opportunity to create a fresh start. So I think framing the current situation as a fresh start is one recommendation. The second thing is that, you know, maybe the like particular reality of this crisis, where so many of us are spending like literally 24/7, you know, it's like the kind of usual temporal and geographic landmarks, like getting up in the morning, like putting on the kind of clothes that we used to wear to work, leaving and walking to a different location to start working. We don't have any of those temporal or geographic landmarks that I think for many of us were what helped us stay productive, et cetera. You got to recreate them. I mean, you just have to recreate them. And I think the best way to do that is to do at least one day in advance. So at least for my family, and I've got two teenagers at home, I think it's helpful to say at dinner, like, what are we all doing the next day? Like, how is it that we're going to get together for meals? Otherwise, it just becomes this undifferentiated blur. And you don't know if it's Tuesday or Saturday. You don't know if it's 11 in the morning or 6 o'clock at night. And I think for some adults, that's just like, you know, a way to be too stressed because you're like constantly working. You never have a respite. And honestly, for some teenagers, it's the opposite. Like, they're just in continual repose and they never actually have any periods of productivity. Speaking personally, my family. So geographic and temporal landmarks, whatever you can do to like recreate those markers. And that will be a way of, I think, in a sense, like making daily fresh starts in addition to thinking of the whole thing as a fresh start.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much, Angela. This was really fantastic, and I really appreciate you taking the time.
Thanks, Katie. I'll talk to you again.